Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. just talk through it. And these are the kind of main controls of the two players. There's the first player is just playing parallel fifths. You can kind of hear when they happen from the oscilloscope. And the first player is controlled by this stuff. This kind of determines the length of everything, and it sets up the time frame up here. It reads from minimum and maximum. They're kind of like the other one. There's a lot of recycled processes from the first one, from the last piece, the Ephemeris I. So yeah, I just kind of copied a bunch of stuff and went from there. There's no reason to build it all from scratch, right? Copy paste. So yeah, so this handles the time interval of the first one, how long it takes. And this part decides that if I noticed that sometimes it was carrying the, okay, this, I should get ahead of myself. This chooses from 8 possible intervals for which it to jump to the, you know, just get jump up, jump down, and by how much. So this, it's kind of outlined here. It just went down by a major third. This just means it goes the last change. Oh, that's the wrong one. Okay. Yeah, I think this should probably be. Okay, this is the heart. Sorry, I got ahead of myself. This is the change. This is where the second pitch comes in relation to the bottom pitch of the parallel fifths. This one is how it moved, how the parallel fifths moved. This went means it went up a whole step, up a minor third, up a major third, up a perfect fourth, and so on. You can see that. And this is the process that decides that. It's by shuffle, so it won't do the same thing twice in a row. This part looks at the pitches, and if it gets too low, then it'll kick it up the next time by an octave, and if it goes too high, it'll kick it down an octave on the next go. So that was because otherwise sometimes if it's a random process, it could just keep going up and you won't be able to hear it eventually. So this kind of kicks things into play, keeps the ball on the pitch. And then so this bit reads the data from these sliders here, which are just straight, you know, attack, decay, and sustain. There's no release because it's not, there is some control, right? You can control the pace of everything, and see that can get kind of, edit mode. So I can bring things down, up and down if I want. This is the ADSR of it, but there's no release because I'm not using a keyboard. So there's no need to put in release data. So this, the attack, as you know, just, is it harsh? Is it soft? You can change that. What's left? The reverb. There's some reverb, you know, can't live without reverb, right? I can't. I will and I'll do. So the second player actually looks at the parallel fifths that's already established, the dyad, and then it'll choose a note from these 12 prescribed notes that I set up, which I think kind of work in the context of whatever parallel fifth is going on. I'm sorry that you're looking at everything so, and I'm shifting around so much. I'll try not to give you a headache. So here, if you notice, okay, this is, we can wait until the next note to ring out. So when it gets over here, then we'll hear another note. Don't worry about the repeating notes right now. That's the B part. So here it comes, where'd it go? Okay, so this means that in the in the chord of dum bum, and this is the major seven dum above that. So that produces a nice major seven chord. So what I'm trying to do here is have them have the different elements reacting to each other, but they're aware of what the others are doing, so that it knows kind of, it kind of makes musicianly kind of decisions instead of just being random and picking whatever note. These parallel fifths move in directions that my hand would tend to go to if I'm just playing parallel fifths in the, say, in the left hand. And these might be color notes to go along with here to produce chords. So that, I wanted to do that. I didn't want it to just be random whatever notes. I want to kind of teach them a little, kind of like I'm teaching the program some basic minor or some basic music theory, harmonic theory, so that they make more, they make better sounding decisions than not. But, and the bass player, which is the next one, I'll show you in a minute, does similar thing. It's going to play either the tonic, the bass note, or it'll go a minor third below the tonic, which is the harmonic minor. I don't know how much music theory you have, but it kind of is trying to be harmonically savvy. The program is, it's not always working because I hope I'm explaining it all right then. Major minor, you know, it's not going too far beyond major and minor chords and stuff. Yeah. It's clear from your music that you understand theory. So sometimes, because things are changing, the other part, say the parallel fifth, will change, and the other elements, the bass and then the single other note part, won't adjust right away. It'll be a little late in adjusting. So that sets up a sort of artificial situation of tension where it's not always going to sound pretty. And that's going to create tension, harmonic tension. But it will right itself eventually. So you can always count on it. Eventually, if there's some weird, you know, harmonic relationship in the chord, if something sounds a little weird or full of tension, it'll eventually, it's designed to kind of right itself, to kind of have a keel, and it'll do the right thing eventually, which is kind of what musicians who are improvising do anyway. See now we're in a major key. I improvise. I'm a jazz musician, and when we're jamming along, we're playing, a lot of times things change unpredictably. The piano player might decide to make a right turn on, you know, Weirdville and play a chord that we weren't expecting, or a voicing that we weren't going for, and we have to kind of be listening all the time and adjusting for what's going on around us so that we can kind of make the best answer to that question that they do. So I thought, you know, if these things can share data between elements, then why couldn't the machine do that? So that's what we're doing. Yeah, we're doomed. The AI is going to destroy us all. But this one won't. This one will just try to make nice music. It'll do its best. So so the other player just makes single notes, and I've kind of changed up the character of the tone a bit for this one, just so you can hear the difference. The attack is harder, and it fades out. It decays a little slower. Here's another one. And this one grabs the tail of the reverb also, so a little bit. It's barely hanging on there. Ooh, I don't have the clip randomizer going. Okay. can't remember where their IO is. Okay, the clip is what, if the waveform shows up here and it looks like it's got chopped off the top. Oh, see, it's not round, right? That's because of these things. Top clip. So what I want to do is adjust that. See, if I open it up completely, then it'll be rounded. There, see? That sounds different. Nice, beautiful sine wave. But if we clip it at the bottom, at the top, it won't do it now because this is just an echo playing. But once we get to here, we hit see another one, you'll see it'll be clipped, so it gives a kind of more edgier tone as this. There. Kind of hear that. So I can randomize that. So what I want to do with this one is just set the top clip completely open and then randomize the bottom clip, because I do the opposite in the bass part. So this is bottom clip, we'll randomize that. But we won't randomize the top clip. So we'll see this moving around each time, but this one will stay at the top. Kind of give a different character to each sound. Let's see if it works. This should move, this should stay. Yep, it worked, okay, so that's cool. Just kind of give a little separation. They don't want all the sounds to sound alike. They're all coming from oscillators. So gotta give them their own character. So that's that. So that's these two trying to catch up with each other. So what's the pulsing noise in the back? That's the bass player. We don't hang out with him too much. He's not as cool. Bass players, you know. Yeah, so bass player. I have to see it myself. Okay, here we go. Bass player. This dude. Did you see the movie Ex Machina? It's kind of an indie film. It's got Oscar, what's his name? Oscar Isaac, yeah. And the guy from Star Wars, and yeah, you know who I'm talking about. You know the guy. It's a great movie. I love that movie. And it's got some killer music in it. And it's these two guys, I can't remember their names at the moment, Ben something, I don't know, I'll look it up later. But the music in that is fantastic. I just love it. And I listen to that all the time. And there's this element that keeps coming, they do this bass line that when things get a little weird and dodgy in the movie, this synthesized bass line just comes on and goes like that. And I just kind of wanted to mess with something like that. So that's me. This is me trying to imitate that a little bit. And I don't use these kind of oscillators very much in my music. I like to use recorded stuff and then manipulate that. But yeah, it's nothing like a good synth bass. I just don't usually try. But I thought I'd try it. But I didn't want to just go do 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 do. I wanted to be able to change the tempo. I wanted to fade it in and fade it out, which is what this is. I also, this one, this bit here where it says 15 and 12. 12 is just lowering one octave, and 15 lowers it an octave and a minor third, which is what's called the relative minor. It's kind of like playing a C scale, except starting on, you know, just the white notes of a keyboard, starting on A, going from A to A, just using the white notes. That's a harmonic minor. And so you can see in this one, the clip is changing quite often here, but the bass, actually, I like bass too, so I'm gonna put this down here, because I want to hear all that bass. This will sound better, but it has to fade back in a minute. Turn up the volume. Here it comes. Oh, that's better. that sounds like Ex Machina. And then it changed. It changed along with the other chord. And now it slowed it way down. Where the tempo slowed way down here. Okay. Yeah, the problem was I didn't initialize the value here on the bottom clip when I started it up. So now it's just going to randomize the top, and it's going to leave the bottom way open. So no clipping of the bass frequencies. So now sounds better. This part is just, it decides the meter. I noticed that I like to hear bass, I don't know about you, but I like to hear bass lines play. I don't want them to change in the middle of the bar too much. Sometimes I do if it's progressive rock, that's cool. But for this kind of thing, I didn't want it to just change whenever it heard the other thing change. I wanted to actually get through a bar before it changed notes. That kind of gives a little less predictability to, I don't know if it's more or less predictable that way, but maybe more predictable. And this is a five note. You can't really hear it, but it will wait before changing pitch until it gets through one of these bars, whether it's four beats, eight beats, five, 16, or 32. And that all depends also on what tempo we're at. So, you know, a bar of four is going to be gone in a flash at 200. So anyway, just different processes to make it sound more like there's a wizard behind the curtain calling the shots. But it's all set up. Okay, that's it. That's all there is to this one. So it just, when I sit back and listen to this one, it's just, it sets up, it gets itself into a pickle sometimes, but then it'll write itself, and everything will be all right pretty soon. So music to me has to have that sort of building of tension and then releasing that tension, and that can be done harmonically. It's not done very rhythmically here. Maybe I'll do that in the next piece. Okay, all right. Oh yeah, more bass. I heard this, that reminds me. I was doing this recording session, and this guy who was from Jamaica was producing the track. And I remember him remarking to the engineer, "We want maximum bass at all frequencies." And that makes sense. It didn't make sense to me at the moment, but I understand it now. You ever mess with an EQ? Maximum bass at all frequencies. I thought that was hilarious. But he knows what he's talking about. He understood what he was talking about. At the time, I was like, how's that possible? But I kind of can see how what he was going for. He means that every band, he wanted maximum bass response. Okay. Maximum bass at all frequencies. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.